How lovely to have you with us. And just a quick introduction, holistic lifestyle coach and integrative medicine. You just co-authored the book, The Magic Weight Loss Pill with Anushka Shetty, as well as The Great Indian Diet with Shilpa Shetty. Well, Luke, you know, the last time I met you, we were walking around freely in your gym. I never thought we'd really be taking all of that for granted. But here we are in our living rooms in Mumbai and Goa, respectively. And I'm going to start off with something that you posted just yesterday. Your only bet right now, you say, and for the future, is your own immunity. So all those whining and complaining about getting their nutrition, exercise, sleep, and emotional wellness in place, choose wisely. Can you elaborate?
Sure. Yeah. Good to see you again. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, we're left at one word right now. A lot of people are waiting for a vaccine to come. A lot of people are waiting for new medicines to come. Let's wait for that. Let's be hopeful. But what can we do in the meantime? It's one word which prime ministers, presidents across the world, doctors, scientists are all literally screaming out: your immune system. Because right now, all the cases of people who are recovering from the virus are recovering because their immune systems are able to help them get better. So when we know it's immunity, we have to start investing in our immune system. So something else to add to our portfolio is your immune system. And I think there are too many people around just complaining and waiting for something to come. You know, human beings always waiting for a problem to be solved by something outwards. Whereas we already have an immune system within us. What can we do to make it stronger is the answer. And the people who build strong immune systems are going to get through this very well. And in case they get the virus, they are going to be able to recover way better than people with lower immune systems. So it's extremely important for us to invest in our immunity.
Oh, yes, indeed it is. And as you said, as of now, we will be waiting for the virus. But in the meantime, we have to continue living our lives. You know, how long are we going to just be confined to the four walls of our homes? So how does one go about that, Luke? If you could give us, you know, a step-by-step guide for, you know, a regular individual without any ailments or diseases, how do you build your immunity?
Sure. The beauty is, even if you have ailments and you invest in your immunity, there's a big chance that those ailments are only going to start getting better. Okay. So immunity is broken down into four verticals. One is your nutrition, your exercise, your sleep, and your emotional wellness. So I'll start off with nutrition. It's simple. A lot of people are Googling superfoods to boost immunity. You don't have to do that. When we look at our own country, let's move down to South India. Your rasam, your sambar, these are superfoods because they contain vegetables and spices, which are already immune boosting. We have our normal fruits and vegetables, which are growing seasonal. Right now, mangoes are in season, but a lot of people are scared of eating mangoes because they think it will make them fat. They should be eating mangoes for their immune system. We moved up north. We have curries, Indian curries. The base of a curry is tomato, onion, garlic, and again, garam masalas. All of these together are immune boosters. Indian food goes wrong when we overeat it. We overeat too many carbohydrates. We replace white sugar. We use white sugar instead of jaggery. We use refined oils instead of really good, pure oils. That's when Indian food gets a bad name. And of course, our lifestyle. So look at our chutneys. Our chutneys are medicine. Literally, they're with fresh ingredients. They got spices. They got chili. They get coconut. Different chutneys. There are over 300 different chutneys in our own country. And all of them are immune boosters. And then you break it down into spices. Turmeric is something that goes into our food. Garlic, ginger. If you're Jain, you don't have to eat garlic and ginger. You can have cruciferous vegetables. We have cabbage. We have cauliflower. We have broccoli. We have your simple rajma chawal, which is your kidney beans and rice. Your khichdi, your dal khichdi, is a superfood. It has amino acids. When we're looking at immunity, we need amino acids. So we're going to find it in complete proteins. In Bihar, you have something called sattu, which is your roasted gram flour. They make a drink out of that. And all of this is available right now while we speak. These are essentials which are available. But, you know, I want to talk about what makes our immune system collapse. It's easier to avoid that. One is white sugar. The more white sugar we consume, the lower our immune system. Two, junk and processed food. The more junk and processed food we eat or we feed our children, your immune system is dropping right down. Because remember, junk food does not provide nutrition to you. It gives you energy. It gives you energy spikes, but no nutrition. Your immune system requires energy and intelligence from the nutrition that you eat. So when it comes down to nutrition, people should not go around spending too much of money on superfoods. Eat your home-cooked meal. Make sure it's balanced. You have fruits, vegetables, nuts, seeds, whole grains, lentils, and your protein. That's what a beautiful, balanced Indian diet is anyway. So we should be eating simple foods right now. Let's move to the next vertical, which is exercise. Today, science and medicine has proven that a sedentary lifestyle leads to almost every possible disease, from cancer to normal hair fall and obesity. That's because we need blood circulation all the time. When you're sedentary, your blood doesn't circulate the right way, and your blood carries nutrition and oxygen from the air that you breathe and the food that you eat, the trillions of cells in your body. What is your immune system? I always explain it to people like, think of an army. You have an army, you have a navy, and you have an air force. Depending on the enemy, the army decides, should I send in the air force? Should I send in the navy? Or should I send in our ground army? Depending on the enemy. Now take that same analogy to the human body. Your immune system is your army. Depending on the virus or the bug or the germ or the pathogen, your immune system decides which part of your immune system to fire. The army, the air force, or the navy. Now, in common, every army to function needs good nutrition for strength, stamina, endurance, good rest and sleep so they're rejuvenated and they can fight, good intelligence, intel to tell them about the enemy, and of course, physical activity to keep them strong. Those are the same things the army within us needs. If our immune system doesn't have nutrition, it doesn't have the vitamins and minerals to be strong. If we don't have activity and blood circulation, the enemy is going to be stronger than us. If we don't have sleep, our immune system is tired. It doesn't have the ability to fight. And our emotional wellness, the same way if an army is constantly stressed out and emotionally managing problems of girlfriends, boyfriends, partners, all of that stuff, they can't fight, they can't focus. Our emotional wellness is real. So exercise has to be really simple. You don't need a gym to get better right now. You can walk if you have space around you on your terrace in your home. You can do body weight exercises. Even just yoga and pranayama is good for you. When it comes to sleep, you know, Dr. Matt Walker, who heads the human sleep sciences in Berkeley College, has a startling statistic that every human being should remember. He did a test on human beings, and the outcome of his research says that one night of sleep deprivation, one night, can disable your immune system by 60 to 70%. You can be the healthiest person. You can have a six pack. You can have a size zero figure. You could be eating organic food throughout the day. But if you don't sleep well, your immune system is disabled. And then the fourth vertical is your emotional wellness. Stress is good for us. But when it becomes chronic, when stress hits us every single day, we start internalizing it. We have negative emotions like fear, anxiety, hatred, anger, you know, the inability to forgive. These are emotions that eat into you, into your immune system, and your immune system is just lowered. So, you know, to build our immune systems, it's not complicated. It is rarely complicated. We just got to give the body what it needs. Nutrition that suits you, exercise that suits you, the right quality and quantity of sleep, and looking after our stress levels. That is immunity in a nutshell.
Well said, the four pillars of strength. And Luke, I want to pick on one of them, stress. I know you said that once it eats into you, it really does a lot of damage. But we're going through trying times here. My managing editor is also on this call. I'm sure he's juggling a ton of things, how to keep the channel alive, how to, you know, keep people's jobs. There's just so much to juggle with at a time like this. So how does one cope? I mean, because stress is inevitable, there will be lots of problems. So how?
So it's difficult, but it's simple. Now, let me explain that, okay? Whenever we have stress, right now, the biggest stress and anxiety is fear of what's going to happen, uncertainty, okay? When we have stress in our life, we look at it this way. Is there anything we can do? If yes, do it. Anything that we can do to make the situation better. If we can't, accept it, okay? We cannot go on living and giving that emotion of fear and stress more and more energy. I always say fear is a wasted emotion. Don't invest in it. There's nothing that you can do about whatever is happening right now. But what we can do is take the energy from all the stress and invest it in what we can do. So if I can make a new line of business, I can learn a new skill, I can do something that's going to make me better for the future, I should put that energy there. Because anxiety and fear is not solving a problem at all. Yes, they are difficult times for everyone. But I think people have to learn the power of acceptance, because there's nothing we can do. If there's something we can do, let's do it. But if we can't, let's not feed that emotion of fear and anxiety, because it's only going to result in us feeling more and more negative, and that's going to really impact our health. So there's a problem. What can I do? What can I do right now to make the most out of what we have? And I think super successful people always use that as a mantra. Okay, it's not about what you have. It's about what you do with what you have. You may have very little, but you can build an empire out of it. People have a lot, but they do nothing with it. So I really think we have to accept and now move on. Action. We can't be victims. When we're victims, we can't do anything. When we're victims, we're stuck in a corner. But when we move out of victim into action mode, a lot of opportunities may open up for us.
Okay, fine. So utilize your energy for more productive things. Luke, you've always spoken about the importance of, you know, utilizing your time well. Just yesterday, we had a webinar with Mark Cuban, and he said that work from home gives me a lot more opportunity to spend more time with my family. You know, just very recently as well, you've posted about living one day at a time. Can you stress a little bit more on the importance of that?
Yeah, sure. See, I mean, we can get nothing from the past, only lessons. Okay, we can get nothing from the future because it's not in our control. The only thing we have is the present, one day at a time. I may have a goal which I want to materialize 5 years later, but I still have to take one day at a time to reach that five-year-old goal. So I would rather invest all my energy in what I have today. There's a vision, there's a plan. There are mistakes from the past that I've learned from. Now I can't give more energy to my vision. I have to give energy to what I have in front of me. So living one day at a time is doing everything that we can. One day, we should stop procrastinating. We should stop letting the past steal from us. And like I always tell people, it all comes down to time management. Today we have billionaires of the world who come to us and they are able to manage their time effectively. So I always tell people, you have to be aware of time wasters. Everyone has time wasters in their life, in the form of social media, in the form of people. Now, social medias are not a bad thing unless it's really taking your time. You can use social media to be very constructive, to learn a new skill. That's good. But if you're mindlessly scrolling, you're mindlessly comparing your lives to people, that's a time waster. And then you can have time waster people in your life who have unnecessary meetings all the time, who take a one-hour meeting to drive a 10-minute point across. These are time wasters. We have 24 hours in a day. Our life has a shelf life. Time is finite. People have to realize that. So planning time for me is very simple. I don't have a 24-hour day. I have a 16-hour day because 8 hours is kept aside for sleep, irrespective. Now, how do I manage my life in 16 hours with family time, patience, exercise, meditation? I'm managing it beautifully, beautifully. But if I keep 24 hours, I'm going to eat into my sleep. I'm going to eat into my exercise time because that's not a priority. We have to do so many other things. So keep your sleep time separate, and most people can manage beautifully on a 16 or 17 hour day when they plan their time the right way.
Yeah, discipline is also very important. You spoke about social media, mobile phones. Is there any sort of rules that you think people should have? Because today our phone is our 11th finger and we can't deny it. We're walking around everywhere with it. We're glued to the screen.
Absolutely. But there are ways, again, even though most of my patients from around the world are on WhatsApp, they're on my phone all the time. I have designated times to look at my phone. If I'm going to look at it mindlessly, I'm going to be, constantly locked into my phone. It's like a negative spiral. I'll look at one message and then I'll look at the second or third. So I have times in a day where I will spend 2 hours on my phone to look through all my messages within that 2 hours. And then with a lot of restraint, I need to put my phone down. It's with me. I am automatically going to do it. See, you can't win the fight against dopamine. It is the dopamine fix that our phones give us. Scroll. We want to constantly energize our mind with something new on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. And the moment we don't have our phone, we feel lost. Why? Because the dopamine falls. To feel good, we need more dopamine. But you can also get dopamine from nature, from love, from relationships, from doing a good job, passion, and so many other things. But today, those things are boring. Because the amount of dopamine that social media can generate is like a drug. It is so much. And that's why people find it difficult to put down their phone. But there's always a way. Organize your time. I'm not saying be off social media. If it's 1 hour you want to spend, give it 1 hour. But after 1 hour, put your phone aside. You've got to get yourself into that discipline of putting your phone away. And then automatically it becomes a habit. But if it's there, and you're mindlessly using it, and you have, you know, you have access to it when you want, it's going to move you deeper into an addiction spiral, and that's when things get dangerous.
I can't see people, but I certainly know that they're nodding in agreement to what you're saying, especially when it comes to
It's easy for me to say it. It's difficult to travel. Yeah. But believe me, to break the dopamine fix, you know, we can't feed it. That's the only way. There is no other way. Motivational talks will not work. The only way is doing it. It's like a drug addict. When a drug addict comes to us, we can't stop them from drugs. We need to put them into rehab, and they still get drugs. They're slowly weaned off it. You can't just pull them off drugs. They go crazy. They'll have problems. So they wean them off the drug. That's dopamine. We got to wean off, and then we got to not feed it too much. And that's when we become in control.
Baby steps. One of the other pillars is you've mentioned is using the power of your mind and visualization. Is that essentially sort of, you know, manifestation? Do you believe a lot in that? What about meditating? Is that a practice that you, you know, you adhere to?
So I think my message for everyone out there is, like, you know, when I have a cancer patient who, you know, walks in to see us every single day, and it is every single day, the one thing I tell them, the most powerful drug that you have right now is not your chemotherapy. It is not the nutrition I'm going to give you. It is your mind. What you believe right now about how your disease, how you're going to go through it, the outcome, is exactly how your journey is going to be. So right then, I try to tell them that it is the power of your mind. Then comes everything else. Then comes everything else. Our mind is everything. Think about it. People who have built billion-dollar empires, it all started off with their mind. They couldn't build it unless they had a thought. From that thought, they had a feeling that drove them, that motivated them. That feeling became a behavior or a choice that they made, and then that translated into the experience. So everything in life starts off from a thought. Then from the thought, we have a feeling. The feeling moves into a behavior. The behavior moves into the result or the experience. Take, for example, an architect. An architect just can't build a house. He's already seen the house, or she's seen the house in her mind. Then she takes that out of the mind and puts it on a paper, which is your blueprint. And now you have the house, which is the physical translation of it. I think today people have to learn that the power of the mind is everything. Manifestation just doesn't happen when we really put out a vision there or a thought out there, and then we surrender it. A lot of people put a vision and then they're constantly chasing it all the time. They're trying to control it. If people want manifestation to happen, they need to put a very clear thought out there. And then with belief and faith, they need to surrender it. How it's going to happen, when it's going to happen, that's not our job. We need to just do the action plan. We need to do the things that will lead us there. And manifestation is beautiful. We see the power of the mind working with people across. I had a 75-year-old cancer patient who walked into my cabin 2 days before lockdown. Her son and daughter came in first and said, Luke, she doesn't know she has cancer. And when she's getting chemo, she actually thinks she's just getting saline. Okay. And she's gone through 19 cycles at the age of 75. So I expected a really, really, you know, a sick woman to enter my cabin after that. But this woman entered. She was jovial. She was laughing. She didn't even look like a cancer patient. She had not suffered one side effect of 19 cycles of chemo, which is miraculous. Everyone knows the side effects of chemo. The power of her mind. She didn't even know she had cancer. She didn't even know she was getting chemotherapy. That is how strong the human mind is. And right now, at a time of this virus, a lot of people's mind will only see the worst. And that is exactly what's going to happen. Yes, there are worse situations out, but you got to train your mind to see the best, to look at opportunity. It's not lying to yourself. Your conscious mind decides with rationale, with logic, right, wrong. That's your thinking mind. But your subconscious mind doesn't know the difference between a lie and the truth. Your subconscious mind doesn't know the difference between imagination and reality. So when you know this truth, you have the power right now to feed your subconscious mind with thoughts and ways that you want your life to be, the way you want your life to be lived. But to reprogram your subconscious mind by thinking that way. And that is the power of the mind. If people are able to use this, it's really simple. It comes with practice. Every time you have negative and sad thoughts or disabling thoughts, don't give it attention. You need to move that energy into a thought of how you would like it to be. Now, we can't change a bad situation, but we can intend in how we want the situation to turn out for us. So you may be poor right now, or you may be sick right now. Yes, that's the present moment, but I can intend for a richer or a wealthier or a healthier future. And that is the power of the mind, by feeding attention and focus and energy to the thoughts which can give us from a life, not take away from us.
Okay, I'm getting some questions in. Shailesh has asked, what is the correct way to do intermittent fasting and what are your thoughts on it?
So intermittent fasting is therapeutic. It is a natural drug that has already always existed for us. Okay, it's only now over the last 15, 20 years that nutrition has become messed up. You know, snacking companies want to sell snacks, so they teach us that snacking is important. But go back 15 to 20 years in traditional India, let's talk about the wisdom of our own country. People finished their meals by sunset and they ate with sunrise. 12 beautiful hours of giving your digestive system a break. Today, my clients who push 18 hours of fasting and 16, there's nothing wrong in 16 to 18. It's just that people have made it a fad. My people are getting that same, those same results of be it weight loss, better immunity, glowing skin, better hair, energy levels, better sleep. These are all the fantastic benefits of fasting. They're getting it in 12 hours by just aligning your rhythm with nature, which means once the sun sets, we shouldn't be having late dinners. If 6:30 is too early, at least 7:30, at least maximum 8 o'clock, but eating at 10 and 11, that is why our country is mainly type 2 diabetic and acidic and has all the gastric problems possible. It's multifactorial, but people eat late dinners. The human body is not designed for late dinners. The earlier you eat, okay, you keep a beautiful 12-hour gap. Wake up in the morning. You're not hungry? Fast for another hour. Still not hungry? Fast for another hour. Listen to your body. No one can tell you that 16 hours is good enough for you. My question to you is, why not 15? Why not 15 and a half? Why not 16 and a half? You won't have an answer. Listen to your body. When people listen to their bodies, some days they'll find that they can fast for 18 hours. The next day they may fast for only 13 hours. They get hungry because your body will finish its work in that fasting period and then ask you for food. So intermittent fasting is powerful, but do not make it into a fad. It is not a competition. It's not about what everyone in the world is doing and everyone saying, I did 16, 18. Like I said, most people are getting results in 12 beautiful hours. It is about your timing and the way you align your choices, your eating time and your sleep time with the cycles of nature. Then your body and your body's intelligence begins to work for you.
Okay, fair enough. You also spoke about superfoods and, going on some of these fad diets. A lot of people tend to do that. In fact, I'm getting a lot of questions saying I'm doing everything, I'm doing all the diets, but I'm still not losing weight. Can you just stress upon that point about, going for some of these, like they say, healthy yogurts or going for superfoods like kale? Today it's kale, tomorrow it's something else. Why not?
Because the fundamental truth is, when I look at data, I was looking at data in Jan of over about 10,000 people who came to us over the years, the last 2-3 years for weight loss. Most people don't need a diet. Most people need a change in lifestyle. You know, there's a lot of people over there who constantly nibble like birds on sunflower seeds, pumpkin seeds and kale. And you don't need that. The fittest and happiest people eat normal food. They eat a balanced diet, but their lifestyles are correct. They're not overeating. They're not eating at different timings every day. They're not eating late night meals. Their exercise is consistent. They sleep sufficiently. And they're in control of their stress levels. Most people do not lose weight because of nutrition. And of course, if you're eating junk food, there's your answer right then. You got to keep your nutrition simple. Fad diets never work. It's not worked for the last 20 years. And that's why people keep searching for the next diet. If it worked, we wouldn't be Googling diets. We wouldn't be Googling all of this stuff. But they don't work. You need to come back down to nutrition that suits you. And remember, if you ever get onto a diet, you need to ask yourself two questions. Is the diet making you happy? If not, you are psychologically and physiologically deprived, and you're not going to be able to get through that diet. It's going to make you sad. When you're sad, you have more cortisol, more stress. Your diet fails right then. Second question is your diet sustainable? If the answer is no, your results are also not going to be sustainable. So I think people have to break away from fad diets and realize that nutrition has to be simple, not according to how the world is eating, but what kind of nutrition suits your body, gives you results, coupled with your adequate exercise, your good quality sleep, and the health of your emotions. You can have the best diet, but you're emotionally stressed. You will not lose weight. In fact, you begin to gain weight. So I think it has to be a balance of lifestyle over diet. Most people have to change their lifestyles. They don't need to change their diets.
It's all about the lifestyle indeed. Now, Luke, you also have, I'm sure, coached a lot of very interesting leaders and thought leaders, and those who have been very successful in their businesses. What have been some of the key learnings from you as to what distinguishes someone who has made it vis-a-vis those that sort of lag behind? What are some of the key characteristics, daily habits, or, you know, factors that one needs to adopt in their lives?
So number one, it comes down to your attitude. If you have the wrong attitude, like, you know, I have patients fill up a form, okay, telling them that if you are coming in with a negative or an arrogant attitude, you know, please don't sign up for a program with us, because there's nothing in the world that can help you. It is always the attitude of the person, okay? People come in with attitudes when they have a problem and they never solve their problem. So the most successful people I see, they have the right attitude. Number one, if there's something wrong, okay, they accept it. They accept that they put on too much of weight. They accept that their poor lifestyle has now gotten them diabetes. Acceptance is number one. Because if you constantly keep denying it, you're never going to get better. No one is going to be able to help you, not yourself, not us. So I think attitude is number one. Number two is knowing your goal. You have to have such a crystal clear vision of what you really want, whether it's your health goal, your financial goal, your relationships goal, your life goals. Most people don't know what they want. So when someone comes in front of me and they say, Luke, you want to lose weight? I say, for what? Why? How does it fit into your vision? They don't know. Oh, you know, just to feel good. That's not a good enough goal, because your goal will drive you and motivate you to stay on path. So it is important. One is attitude. Two is your goals. And three is self-discipline. Every leader, every successful leader is able to use and practice self-discipline every single day. You see, motivation is a joke. We don't need motivation if we're disciplined. Because guess what? You may get motivated today, but tomorrow, if you don't have discipline, motivation isn't going to last. You need to be motivated again and again and again. Okay, motivation is not a fuel. We can use it. Coupled with discipline, motivation is gold. So we need to understand that self-discipline is the trait of every one of my patients today from cancer who are in remission. Every one of my billionaire clients today who have reversed their conditions. Anyone who comes to me, the successful people have maintained discipline. They are alignment with what they want, their goal, and they have the right attitude. They're open to learning. They listen. They want to learn. They don't, you know, like I have a common patient who comes to me and I put them in a different bucket of not successful on day one. They come and say, I have five problems, but I can't do this, 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 and I want this, 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 this. Now help me. We refund their money and tell them, sorry, we can't help you. You know, we can't help you at all. You're not going to get better. And we don't want to be bad and not helping you get better. So these are the top three traits: self-discipline, respect for time, because time is finite. Time is finite, your vision, clear-cut vision, and your attitude.
Okay. So
I can hear you now. Yeah.
Okay, super. Now, you know, you were talking about motivation, and I'm getting lots of questions saying it's such a tough time like this. People are so stressed. How do you even manage to keep yourself motivated? And then there's also that debate that you have in your mind. Am I doing enough or am I being too paranoid? I'm not asking you to tell me the right way to deal with this or how I can, you know, cure myself if I do get caught by the virus, but what should be one's mindset? Because it is a tough time. Things are going to change. Now, once I go back to my workplace, things are not going to be the same. So how do I prepare myself at a time like this and the motivation?
So it always comes down to mindset. I have a question that I ask a lot of people who are coming to us with, you know, self-labeled depression now because of being at home. I ask them before the lockdown, okay, you still had problems. They were just not this kind of problem, but you still had problems. A lot of people had problems. It's a mindset. This is a different problem. It comes with uncertainty. But remember, everyone is going through this problem. The first thing that we need to do is understand. And this is a lesson that lockdown should teach us. You know, so it'll answer your question in many, many ways. The human mind, what has happened over the last couple of years? And that's why, even though we live in a world where we have so much more spending power, we have more entertainment, we have technology, we have doctors, nutritionists, gyms, superfoods, the numbers of depression, suicides, and emotional wellness, distress is at its highest. What's wrong? I'll tell you what's wrong. This human mind and this heart, okay, is meant to be connected within. We are meant to be connected within. But over the years, all of us are connected outwards. You know what happens? we are controlled by the opinions of society. We are controlled by the news that we watch on TV every day. We are controlled by debates, everything that's happening, because we are connected outwards. So someone says something, our mind moves there. Someone new says something, our mind moves over there. So literally our mind, you know, we're like puppets. We're being controlled by everything around us. Now think about that. You're no longer in control of yourself because you're not connected within you anymore. If you're connected outwards, from one person to 100 people to 1,000 people can control your every thought and your every emotion. Okay? We can be connected outwards, but the connection inside has to be stronger. Most people today don't know how to make decisions for themselves. They're looking for validation all the time. They may have a very strong gut feeling about what is right for them, but they won't do it unless they get validation from their friends, from society, and from everything else. What is the end product of being puppets? Misery, depression, constantly comparing ourselves, constantly feeling inadequate, even when we have so much, the inability to feel grateful. All of these things we have to understand. That is why meditation is so important. There may be chaos in the world right now, but when we are calm within, which comes with your meditation, your spiritual practice, your exercise, and your practice of gratitude, you may not have so much, the world's taken away from you, but you still have something you can be grateful for. And it's these little things that are gold, that are power drugs for people. And if they practice it right now and connect within, they are going to be able to get through not the storm right now, but future storms that the world throws to us.
Luke, I could go on and on and on. There's a plethora of questions in my mind, and you've been ever so enlightening, but I'm afraid we're done with our time. So thank you so very much for connecting with us and giving us all of those pearls of wisdom. I'm sure you've really helped out a lot of people.
Thank you so much. Stay safe, everyone.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.